Every cell in human body has glycolysis, which is a unique feature. Glycolysis occurs in the cytoplasm, and the general picture of glycolysis is that after intake of carbohydrate meal, glucose level in the blood increase. Tissues uptake glucose from the blood by a glute transporter, and inside the cell in the cytoplasm, cell degrades glucose into pyruvate with simultaneous release of two ATP molecules and two NADH molecules. And at this stage, everything depends on how much oxygen tissue have. Let's suppose that tissue have sufficient amount of oxygen. In this case, NADH delivers electrons to electron transport chain, and this results in generation of ATP molecules. And NADH is converted into NAD, and NAD is recycled back. And pyruvate with sufficient amount of oxygen in the tissue is transported into mitochondrial matrix, and in the mitochondria, pyruvate is converted into acetyl-CoA, and acetyl-CoA undergo degradation in the Krebs cycle that results in formation of NADH and FADH molecules. And then these electron carriers deliver electrons to electron transport chain, and this results in energy production. So overall, aerobic glycolysis results in production of 36 to 38 ATP molecules. However, if tissue have low amount of oxygen, in anaerobic condition, electron transport chain is not working. So now the function of the Krebs cycle become useless because electron transporters cannot deliver electrons for energy production. So in this condition, Krebs cycle is inhibited. And in this situation, NADH molecules that are generated during degradation of glucose into pyruvate donates electrons not to electron transport chain, but to pyruvate, with formation of lactic acid. And this glycolysis that occurs without oxygen and results in formation of a lactic acid called anaerobic glycolysis. As we see, anaerobic glycolysis results in production of only 2 ATP molecules. So let's discuss glycolysis in details. When glucose by glute transporter enter into the cell, it immediately converted by hexokinase to glucose 6-phosphate. This enzyme called hexokinase because glucose is hexose, and because this enzyme uses ATP. Hexokinase basically binds phosphate group to glucose, and by this binding of phosphate group, it basically traps glucose inside the cell. Glycolysis is a process that generates energy, so the logical question is that why to invest ATP to bind phosphate in a process that have to generate energy? The concept is that glucose in a free state can freely leave the cell by a glute transporter. So to trap glucose inside the cell, hexokinase binds to glucose phosphate group, and now glucose with phosphate group cannot be transported by a glute transporter. So once glucose have phosphate group, glute transporter cannot transport it out of the cell. Thereby, hexokinase by binding of phosphate group traps glucose inside the cell, and now there is no way back for glucose. The alternative option for hexokinase is glucokinase. Glucokinase is present in liver tissue and also in pancreatic beta and alpha cells. But in pancreatic beta and alpha cells, glucokinase functions as glucose sensor. Here, I will not go into the details about the difference between these two enzymes, because the outcome in both cases is glucose phosphorylation with formation of glucose 6-phosphate. Then glucose 6-phosphate is converted to fructose 6-phosphate, and fructose 6-phosphate is converted by the major enzyme in glycolysis, phosphofructokinase 1, to fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. Then fructose 1,6-bisphosphate is cleaved into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and dehydroxyacetone phosphate. Dehydroxyacetone phosphate can be used to form triacylglycerols, but also dehydroxyacetone phosphate can be converted into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. And then glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is oxidized by glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase that use NAD as cofactor to 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. As we see, this reaction results in formation of NADH. And if cell at this particular moment has enough amount of oxygen, then NADH is going to mitochondria where it donates two electrons to electron transport chain and converted back to NAD. And now glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase can use this electron carrier again in oxidative reaction. So this NAD recycling is possible only in aerobic condition, because oxidative phosphorylation is possible only when substantial amount of oxygen is present in the tissue. And electrons in electron transport chain undergo oxidative phosphorylation as it results in energy production. Then 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate, with help of phosphoglycerate kinase, directly phosphorylates ADP molecule, and as a result ATP molecule released, and 3-phosphoglycerate is formed. This reaction called substrate-level phosphorylation. In such reaction, the energy that is contained in the substrate is directly transmitted to ADP or GDP. Then, in two consecutive steps, 3-phosphoglycerate is converted into phosphoenol pyruvate. Phosphoenol pyruvate, in a reaction that is catalyzed by a pyruvate kinase, directly phosphorylates ADP molecule. As a result, ATP is released and pyruvate is formed. It's the second example of substrate-level phosphorylation. And overall, we have three reactions of the substrate-level phosphorylation. The first one is catalyzed by phosphoglycerate kinase in a reaction where 3-phosphoglycerate is formed. The second one is a reaction catalyzed by pyruvate kinase where pyruvate is formed. And the third reaction occurs in the Krebs cycle, where succinyl-CoA is converted by an enzyme, succinyl-CoA synthetase, to succinate. So two reactions of substrate-level phosphorylation occur in glycolysis and one reaction in the Krebs cycle. Once pyruvate is formed, pyruvate is going into the mitochondria. We know that mitochondrial membranes are practically impermeable, but the specific feature of pyruvate is that this substance can enter into the mitochondria because mitochondria have the specific protein called pyruvate translocase that transports pyruvate into the mitochondrial matrix. In the mitochondrial matrix, most of pyruvate molecules are oxidized by pyruvate dehydrogenase to acetyl-CoA. Generally, acetyl-CoA can be used by two pathways. First of all, if tissue requires energy, so when ATP stores are low, acetyl-CoA can be degraded in the Krebs cycle and subsequently in the electron transport chain with energy production. If tissue's energy stores are full, so when ATP stores are high, acetyl-CoA can be used for fatty acid synthesis. And also important that only in the liver tissue, acetyl-CoA can be used for ketone bodies production. So, if tissue requires energy, acetyl-CoA binds to oxaloacetate with formation of a citrate, which is an intermediate metabolite of the Krebs cycle. And citrate is going through the Krebs cycle, where dehydrogenases pluck out electrons out of acetyl-CoA molecule, and this results in formation of NADH and FADH molecules. And these NADH and FADH electron carriers deliver electrons to electron transport chain that results in energy production. But what happens in anaerobic condition when the amount of oxygen is very low? First of all, electron transport chain with oxidative phosphorylation without oxygen are not working. The major problem here is the reaction where glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate is oxidized to 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate in a reaction that is catalyzed by glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate dehydrogenase. And this enzyme as cofactor use NAD. Thereby this reaction results in formation of NADH. And in aerobic condition, NADH delivers electrons to electron transport chain, and when NADH gets rid of electrons, NADH is converted into NAD, and now glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate dehydrogenase can catalyze another oxidative reaction. But in anaerobic condition, electron transport chain is not working. And the problem is that now without electron transport chain, NADH cannot get rid of electrons. But NADH anyway must be converted back to NAD because there are a lot of enzymes in our body that use NAD as cofactor. For example, glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate dehydrogenase. This enzyme cannot use for oxidative reaction NADH, only NAD. So these NADH molecules have to find something to which they can donate these electrons. And the solution here is lactate dehydrogenase. Lactate dehydrogenase is an enzyme that is located in the cytosol, and this enzyme can convert pyruvate into lactate. Basically, lactate dehydrogenase catalyzes conversion of pyruvate to lactate and lactate into pyruvate. So this enzyme works in both directions. Everything depends on the amount of NAD and NADH in the tissue. So when NAD prevails, lactate is converted into pyruvate. If NADH prevails, pyruvate is converted into lactate. So in this case, lactate dehydrogenase is the only possibility for NADH to get rid of electrons. And NADH molecules see lactate dehydrogenase and pyruvate, they come to lactate dehydrogenase and basically with help of lactate dehydrogenase, they massively donate electrons to pyruvate, that results in conversion of pyruvate into lactate, and simultaneously NADH are converted back to NAD. And now glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate dehydrogenase at least can convert glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate into 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. So this electrons donation to pyruvate with formation of lactate basically maintains activity of glycolysis, and this permits to generate ATP molecules in anaerobic condition. Also important that in anaerobic condition, pyruvate stays in the cytosol in form of lactate. So this transportation of pyruvate into the mitochondria basically disrupted. And this makes sense because the function of the Krebs cycle is to produce NADH and FADH molecules that have to deliver electrons to electron transport chain. But in anaerobic condition, electron transport chain is not working. So basically in anaerobic condition, Krebs cycle and electron transport chain become totally useless, and entire energy generation process occurs only in the cytosol. So only glycolysis can function in anaerobic condition. Because for example in beta oxidation of fatty acids, energy can be generated only in electron transport chain. But in glycolysis, as we see, these ATP molecules are generated in the cytosol. So exactly this feature makes glycolysis the only possibility to produce energy in anaerobic condition. The longer is the period of oxygen deficiency, the more lactate molecules accumulate, and when these lactate molecules are released into the blood, this causes increase in blood lactate level. And because lactic acid is acid, lactate causes decrease in blood pH, a condition known as lactic acidosis. So how many ATP molecules are generated in glycolysis? We see that initially one ATP is consumed by hexokinase or glucokinase, another one by PFK1, so at initial stage of glycolysis two ATP molecules are consumed. Now important that fructose 1,6-bisphosphate is cleaved into two molecules, and this results in formation of two glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate molecules. So from this stage everything is multiplied by 2. So two ATPs are generated by phosphoglycerate kinase, and two ATPs are generated by pyruvate kinase. So at this stage, 4 ATPs are generated and 2 ATPs are consumed. 4 minus 2 is 2, thereby glycolysis itself generates 2 ATP molecules. And in anaerobic condition, because electron transport chain is not working, 2 ATP molecules is all that we can produce. However, if electron transport chain is working, then 2 pyruvate molecules are converted into acetyl-CoA molecules, and 2 acetyl-CoA molecules goes into the Krebs cycle, and this results in production of NADH and FADH molecules. And then NADH from the glycolysis itself and NADH and FADH molecules from the Krebs cycle are delivered to electron transport chain that results in production of 34 ATP molecules. And 2 ATP molecules from glycolysis itself plus 34 ATP molecules that are produced in electron transport chain gives 36 ATP molecules. So in anaerobic condition, we can produce just 2 ATP molecules. In aerobic condition, glucose degradation results in production of 36 ATP molecules. So it's a general concept of glycolysis. And in the second part, we will discuss how glycolysis is regulated.